So is this something that you have been missing in your golfing life? A 70 degree lob wedge for ultimate backspin. My name is Peter Finch, and if you are new to the channel, please hit that subscribe button, please hit that like button as well, and comment below on everything that you see in today's video. And it is all going to be about how you can create the maximum amount of backspin using your wedges, and also if a super high lofted wedge is actually going to be useful for your game. So a few weeks ago, I had an idea to take one of these wedges. Now, this is a high toe wedge, and the loft normally is at 64 degrees, but the guys on the TaylorMade Tour Truck, they actually bent this back, so it is now at 70 degrees of loft. Now, my belief behind this was that I'd get a super high lofted wedge in 70 degrees, and then I'd start to see ridiculous amounts of backspin, but actually, something quite interesting began to happen. Yes, I was generating backspin, but not really in the way that I expected. Now, a little bit more about this wedge. So like I said, 64 degree bent to 70, but the bending process has altered the bounce angle. Now, the reason that's important for this video is as you add more bounce onto a wedge, it is going to bounce more off a firmer lie. So off a firm, hard surface and off a really tight lie, this probably won't be that good anyway. But off a nice soft lie, as it is at the moment in the UK, it actually was pretty worthwhile to use. And also out of bunkers, it was ridiculous, as you'll see. Now, before we dive into the test results of using this 70 degree wedge, let's actually switch over to the Swing Quest cam and have a look at how you can generate the maximum amount of backspin when hitting wedge shots generally. So when trying to generate that backspin, we are looking for a few things. Now, first of all, we need speed. We need that speed to be generated to get the revs up on the golf ball. We also need control over swing arc. That means the place where that club is bottoming out at the point of impact. We also need control over the amount of loft being used at impact and strike location, which is very, very important. Now, the first thing you want to be understanding about what happens at the point of impact is something called spin loft. So you can break spin loft down into a super, super technical, but generally it's the approximation of the angle between the dynamic loft and the angle of attack. If you really want to get into it, it also can factor in the angle and the direction of the club head as it's moving through impact. So that brings into account both the path and the angle of attack. But for this, we're going to be just focusing on the dynamic loft and your angle of attack. But very simply, if you subtract the angle of attack from your dynamic loft, that is going to be your spin loft. Now, what this means is that when you're hitting your wedge shots, you want to be maximizing the amount of loft that you have at impact. And that's why you're having a really heavy shaft lean, so leaning the shaft a long way towards the target, isn't the best idea. That means you're de-lofting the club and therefore you are taking potential backspin off the club face. What this also means is if you have a big angle of attack, so you hit down on the ball a long way, remember that is going to be changing your dynamic loft and your potential spin loft. Therefore, hitting down on the ball and putting your hands a long way ahead of the ball will decrease the amount of backspin that you put on the golf ball. So with that knowledge, we understand that you need a shallower angle of attack, you need to be presenting a lot of loft at the point of impact, and you need to be increasing the club head speed to get those revs up. Now, we all have to factor this in with quality of strike. Quality of strike is obviously very, very important. So for technique, this is what I want you to try and do. Stand with your feet quite close together because you don't need the big wide stance when you're hitting short range shots. It's not about power, it's just about controlling low point, even though you do want to generate speed. So once you've got that stance, you've got a neutral shaft position, so it's standing pretty much straight up, pointing at your belt buckle, then go ahead and put about 60% of your body weight onto your front foot. We don't want to be hitting down too much, but we also don't want to be striking the ball too much behind the ball. That's going to decrease the amount of friction that you can get between the ball and the club face. And friction is very, very important. The actual point of impact on the wedge that you strike, that's going to give big benefits to overall backspin. And we're going to be getting into this a little bit later on in the video with the big 70 degree wedge. Now, other factors are involved in making sure that you can generate maximum amount of backspin. And let's have a look at those now. So the quality of the greens is important. A nice fast running green, which is soft, will allow that ball to spin a little bit more. Also, we want to be using a very good premium ball with a nice soft cover. The fact is, a nice soft ball is going to be spinning more than a really hard one. The type of lie also makes a big difference. If you have a very tight line, there's nothing to interfere with the ball and the face, that's how you're going to be able to generate the maximum amount of friction and the maximum amount of spin. So from a technique standpoint and some of the things that you'll also need in place to generate maximum backspin, that is what you need to know. Like I said, there's so much more that we could get into. However, let's have a look at some of the data that we took when using this 70 degree wedge. So I was testing out this 70 degree wedge at the Quest Golf Academy and on the golf course as well, just to see what it would be like. And the first thing to say is, when you have something with that much loft and with the high toe design, which generally I really, really like, it does kind of look like a frying pan looking back at you when you're getting set up. And that's slightly disconcerting. Also, when I was trying to hit full shots with this, the launch angle was so extreme that it was so difficult to actually have a controllable distance. And what that actually meant is that the only really controllable distance that I had when hitting shots on the GC quad and getting the ball data was about 50 yards. So we settled down into about a 50 yarder. And let's have a look at the spin differences between the 70 degree and my normal 60 degree lob wedge. So you see here with the backspin, 5,600 on the first shot, then down to 3, then up to 8.5, then up to 7.6, down to 7.6, then up to 8.4. It was almost uncontrollable, even at 50 yards, to actually generate the right amount of backspin. Now, one of the reasons that I wasn't able to generate the amount of backspin that I wanted with this shot was strike location. So my strike location using the quad was to be shown quite high on the club face and towards the heel. Now, the best place to actually strike a wedge is towards the bottom of the club, not obviously off the bottom groove, but just slightly above that leading edge. Now, launch monitors have shown that the amount of friction that you can create from a strike around this part of the wedge is greater, but it also launches the ball a little bit lower, so you get higher amounts of friction, higher amounts of spin, but actually a lower launch. This is why you may be on the course and you hit that one which you think is slightly thin, but actually when it hits the green, it stops, grabs, and actually rips back a little bit. That is why. That's because the point of friction at that point on the golf club is at its highest. Now, the only way that I found to be able to control the 70 degree wedge, even at that 50 yard shot with a decent amount of backspin, was to actually hood the face a little bit to try and get that strike a little bit more towards the center and a little bit lower, and almost play like a little low hook. And you can see with the spin rates, they were pretty consistent, 7.8, 7.8, 7.9, 7.5. I did actually get one up at 9 as well. But of course, this is kind of defeating the point of having that really high lofted wedge if I'm having to de-loft, put it at the back of my stance and hit like a little low checky thing. And what you can see here is I use my 60 degree to the same target, and actually the spin rates that I was generating generally were higher. So it just goes to show that a real maximum amount of loft on a lob wedge, it doesn't guarantee the backspin. What it did guarantee was a very high launch. So what this was showing is that 70 degree wedge, even though it wasn't spinning as much and it was harder to control on the full shots, it was launching much, much higher. And that then starts to move into what actually it would be good for on the golf course. So if you're trying to hit a high flop shot, if you're trying to get it over a bunker, those types of shot, they're not actually generating that much backspin. So when you see Phil Mickelson hit that amazing flop shot, there's not that much spin on the ball. It's just descent angle, which is stopping the ball pretty much where it sits. And on the golf course, that's what I was finding. So I was hitting shots out of the fairway that were landing and stopping pretty quick, but there really wasn't that much backspin on it. It's just that they were flying up past my left ear. And out of the bunker, oh my word, it was absolutely awesome. I led that club a little bit flatter, just swung, and it just popped out and landed super, super soft. So as a spin experiment, the 70 degree wedge really didn't do it. I wasn't able to generate the friction, a consistent launch, and control the rate. However, what it did show is that a super high lofted wedge like this with a large amount of bounce in certain situations, so a very high flop shot and that of bunkers, it really, really did work quite well. And also on the FSX skill challenge. Talk about having a specific club for a specific job. So the first, the second, and the third shots, this is what I used in my successful world record. Guys, if you've not checked out that video, make sure you do. It's literally been kind of a long time and a lot of effort to manage to secure that world record. So go check it out. I'll link it in the video now. So guys, thank you so, so much for watching. Make sure that if you are new to the channel, hit that subscribe button, hit that like button, and comment below on everything that you've seen in today's video with this super high wedge. Do you have a lob wedge? Do you use a very high over 60 degree lob wedge? I would love to know and would love to hear your results. And remember, this is my experiment. So this is what has been accurate to the way I strike the ball and the shots that I hit. But it is perfectly possible that someone else has tested this and got different results. Right guys, thank you so much for watching and we'll see you down here next time.